references that I found in the, that were listed before. Let's back up just a minute and talk a little bit about the Karanka Indians. They are well known in this area. They were indigenous to this area. This area being from around Galveston to south of Baffin Bay. Coastline and inland, about 50 miles. They migrated back and forth with the season. It's not clear either the Karanka or their ancestors were in this area 1,000 years ago, but they had no written language, and so it's kind of hard to know exactly who was here. The campsites have been found and documented, but they don't have any characteristic Karanka features. One of the things that the Karankas are often burdened with is that they were cannibals. And I did some looking into that. And I would say, well, yes, they were, but they were, I guess, what is sometimes called ritual cannibals. That is, they would eat parts of their enemies as part of a victory ritual. In the historical record, the Karankas were first encountered by Cabeza de Vaca. Cabeza de Vaca was shipwrecked with a group of about 80 Spaniards on the coast, somewhere around Galveston, probably not on Galveston Island. But they were taken care of, rescued, really, saved their lives. The Karankas took care of them. Cabeza de Vaca spent some time with them and eventually walked from that area. It took him 6 years, but eventually walked from there to the Pacific coast and to the Spanish settlements there. And Cabeza de Vaca wrote about his experiences in his Helicon, which he wrote after he got back to Spain. The next encounter was in 1685 with La Salle and a group of French colonists who came ashore in Matagorda Bay and attempted to establish a colony there on the banks of Matagorda Bay. La Salle managed to irritate and alienate the Karankas, which La Salle was very good at doing with anybody he encountered. And eventually, the colony, after about 2 years, was wiped out by the Karankas, although the French children were adopted into the Karanka tribe. And later on, when they were ransomed, later they provided a lot of information. Unfortunately, La Salle also brought some of the European epidemic diseases, and so these were, we're talking about smallpox, measles, typhus, and this began the ravages of the Karankas. The population at the time of La Salle's entry was estimated to be about 8,000, but by 1750, that had dropped to about 2,500, primarily due to the diseases, although there was also warfare with the Spanish colonials. The population was down to about 1,000 in 1820, and 1821 is when the Anglo immigration started with the Stephen F. Austin colony at San Felipe. By 1840, because of the constant warfare and the additional bouts of epidemics, the numbers by 1840 were only a few hundred. And in 1852, there was a battle at Hines Creek, in which there were only something like 100 Karanka survivors, and they retired to Mexico. And so after 1852, there were essentially no Karankas left in Texas. This two, and you can see that the tattoos, the spots. This is actually a piece of cane through the lip. This is also pieces of cane passing through near the nipple of the male chest. The women were similarly tattooed, and these tattoos were applied around birth. The French children that survived LaSalle's colony were tattooed soon after they were captured, and those tattoos lasted all their lives. And this will turn out to be kind of important later on. Next. This is the part of the beige around here. And of course, we are someplace right around here on Mustang Island. All of the story happens here on Kokomo Bay. And this map shows a lot of the ancient places as well as the current places. For example, it shows El Kokomo here, St. Mary's of Aransas there. Bayside is the current town, but it wasn't started until 1907. And of course, Portland is modern also. But this kind of gives you the Rockport and Fulton are there. So this is a montage of places, ancient and new. Next slide. I'm sorry, I know you can't read this, but this is a very important document that I found in the archives or in the records in the Refugio County Clerk's office. It is a handwritten document by John Howell Wood, done in 1855, in which he is asking to be the guardian of Mary and Domingo Amaro. There's no mention in here of Caracalla or anything else. However, what you can't quite see is further down in here, it mentions Mary's parents as Thomas and Casalita Amaro. This document was done in 1855. It says that Mary and Domingo are orphans. I kind of take this to mean that that is the year that Mary's parents died. And one of the first things that you might think about is, it also talks about an estate. The estate consisted of some head of cattle. And so you might think, well, this is very strange that a Caracalla Indian should have an estate and have guardianship and so forth. So this document provides a lot of information, and it also begins to provide some contrary information about the legend of Mary as the last Caracalla. The names Thomas and Casalita seems Hispanic, not Indian. So this was a very important document. It is in the handwriting of John Howland Wood, who has a house that still exists in Bayside that he built in 1875. So John Howland Wood's name is very big in Bayside. Next slide, please. This is another part of the record. This is the marriage record of Refugio County. And it says that Mary Amaro was married to a Charles Pathoff on the 13th of January, 1859. The witness to that marriage were the Powers and families and the Wood family. And what we will see is that Mary maintained a close relationship throughout her life with a number of these founding families. Next slide, please. This is the timeline for Mary Morrow that I've been able to reconstruct. It seemed that in 1840, Mary was born someplace in Refugio County around 1842. And her brother Domingo, sometimes called Tom, was probably born just a year or two later. In 1855, Mary and her brother were orphaned and adopted by a number of the Irish immigrant families, the Powers, the Welders, the Woods. As we saw, and Mary was married in 1859 to Charles Frederick Patoff. I've been able to find basically nothing at all about him. He was a German immigrant, born in Prussia, but other than that, I don't know how old he was or where he came in or anything like that. In 1860, which was the first census, Mary Patoff was listed as living in El Pocono, and we saw that on the maps on Pocono Bay. She has a baby son, Tom. Her husband, Charles, was listed as a laborer. During the Civil War, no date, 1863-1865, Charles Patoff joined the Confederate Army, goes off, and didn't return. So he died in the Civil War. Domingo Amaro also joined the Confederate Army, and I found the records for him in the in his unit in the Confederate Army. Mary, sometime during the Civil War, moved from El Pocono to St. Mary's of Aransas, which was just right down the bay. In 1870, after the war, Mary, Tom, and Domingo are listed in the Refugio census as living in St. Mary's of Aransas. In 1880, only Mary and Tom are listed in the Refugio census. Part of the legend is that Domingo died or was killed after the Civil War. There's various stories as to how that happened, none of which could be corroborated. But at that point, by 1880, Mary is, Domingo is gone. And we'll see a copy of that 1880 census here in just a minute. There was a move from St. Mary's of Aransas to Beeville around this time. In 1910, Mary is listed in the B County census, and in fact, it's without Tom. Her son had died by 1910. And in 1911, Mary died and is buried in a cemetery in Beeville in the Weller plot, one of the families that she had a long-time relationship with. This is a copy of the page of the 1880 census. And you can't read it, but they're very Patoff and Tom. One of the interesting things about this, and it's true for all the censuses, Mary is listed as white, housekeeper. Her father is listed as being born in Mexico, and her mother as being born in Texas. Tom next slide, please. In 1885, which is the oldest tax records that the Refugio County still has, I guess they just lost the record before 1885. But Mary Amaro is listed as a homeowner in St. Mary's of Aransas, and it identifies the lodge lot number. This is my reconstruction of what St. Mary's of Aransas looked like around 1869. Here's the Pocono Bay, there's the wharf, there's at the Main Street, and the house where Mary lived, right there. Now, it's unclear when Mary moved from St. Mary's of Aransas to Beeville, because the Gulf Coast was hit by a succession of hurricanes in 1869, 1875, 1886, 1887. The ones in 1886 were particularly devastating, two in the same year, and one of them was a Category 4 hurricane, and it destroyed St. Mary's of Aransas and Indianola. Indianola is just up in, on Matagorda Bay. And neither one of them were rebuilt after that hurricane. Sometime in that period, the Wood and Welder store moved to Beeville, and Tom was listed as moving, as an employee and moving with the store to Beeville. So I guess Mary possibly moved with him at the time, or subsequent to that move. So I don't have an exact date for her to go to Beeville. Next slide. A number of the houses in St. Mary's of Aransas were moved to Beeville. So I went up to Beeville to see if I could find any of these houses. And in fact, I found several of them. This Camp Ezel house was moved from St. Mary's of Aransas to Beeville. And there was a hotel, Hotel Ellis, was taken down board by board and moved to Beeville and reconstructed on the square in Beeville. And there was one house that I found that the story goes, it was moved whole without taking it apart. It's hard to imagine how they did that, but that's the story anyway. But anyway, there are a number of houses in Beeville that were places where people moved from, say, now of course they moved to other places as well, Victoria, some of the Refugio. Beeville is not exactly the first place you think of. It is a little bit further away from St. Mary's. Next slide, please. Mary's house, I looked for Mary's house in Beeville, but there was nothing where it should have been. It was somewhere around 511 on Kennedy Street in Beeville. The census didn't exactly list the addresses, but you could kind of figure out it was either next door or across the street. So anyway, that's where she ended her days. Her occupation was listed as dressmaker. When she died, she was buried in the Welder plot, and that is a picture of her headstone, May 21st, 1911. Next slide, and the last slide. So what can we say about Mary of Amaro? Well, she was definitely born at the end of the Carranco era in the Coastal Bend or on the Gulf Coast. She may have been part Carranco. What part, we can't say. I mean, her mother's name certainty, if Mary was not full grown, or she would have had facial tattoos. Since the children were tattooed soon after birth, she would have gone through life with those tattoos, and that might have made it a little hard for her to pass for life. She was one of the very few, I guess the only, named Cron Wood in her Anglo society. She did pass for life. It's kind of interesting that the census had a number of ethnic categories. White, black, mulatto, Indian, Chinese. They did not have a category for Hispanics, which I thought was kind of unusual. Mary's life was rather unremarkable for the time, or maybe rather characteristic of the time. Living on the coast, suffering the privations of the Civil War, and then the devastation of the coast caused by that series of hurricanes. However, one thing certainly about Mary is she was beloved by a number of the pioneer Anglo families, the Woods, the Welders, the Powers, and they supported her in some sense all of her life, since she is now buried in a Welder plot in the cemetery in Beeville. On the basis of this, she would probably be very surprised to learn that she is the subject of a legend. I would be happy to answer any questions that you might have. Yes?
You mentioned they were Irish immigrants.
Yes.
What generation? Were they first generation or?
First. Well, let's see. They came from Ireland. Is that what you mean?
Right.
Yeah. Here was the deal. The same kind of circumstance that Stephen F. Austin had was, it was impresario grant from, at that time, the Mexican government, mainly Mexico over both in Spain. And so Stephen F. Austin got a grant of 300 families, while there were a number of other Irish immigrants, some of whom were already living in Mexico, but they wanted to get grants also. Power and Hewitson were two of one, Power's the same one that I've been talking about. And so they got a grant for several hundred families. They recruited these families directly from Ireland and from recent Irish immigrants on the East Coast, around New York, Baltimore, Philadelphia, and so forth. The Irish who had immigrated to the East Coast found themselves kind of at the bottom rung of the economic ladder. And so Power was able to make a very persuasive case, cheap land, and as he said, gold laying around on the ground. And very fertile and pleasant climate and so forth. So the people that Howard Hewson and the other Irish impresarios brought in were all either directly from Ireland or recent immigrants from Ireland living on the East Coast. Did that answer your question? The Irish came in almost exclusively through El Popo. The Germans immigrants, who came a little bit later, in fact, they came, there was a window of opportunity when the Mexicans allowed immigration. That window of opportunity was like 1828 to about 1833. the German immigrants started coming into Indianola, which is right up the coast, in the 1840s, 1845. But while there were a few Germans in the Irish, they weren't exclusively Irish. But the Irish were desired, the Mexican government thought they wanted people. They became very uneasy with the Anglo that came in with Stephen at Boston because they had ideas about freedom and things like this. And so the Mexicans specified Catholic missions. And of course, most of the Irish were Catholic. And so that fit very well. There's another question here.
The drawing was, you know, growing up in Texas, we have these little pamphlets they pass out to us from elementary school to junior high. And they always talk about the Corantos, you know, the lighting and barbecue and grease. That was one of the main things. So you're saying they were pretty much like everybody else. They might have practiced a little bit of ritual cannibalism, but there wasn't really eating the meat, for example.
I would think that's true.
Can you repeat the question, please?
All right. The question has to do with the image presented that many people got out of the Quran was, I mean, one of the first things, and I still read it, they are called cannibals. And something about eating the missionaries and so forth. I have read that all the Indian tribes in Texas practice ritual cannibalism except for the Comanches. The Comanches thought so well of themselves that they couldn't gain anything by eating So, now, I don't think I can say, and I don't know that anybody can say that you know, there was never a case of cannibalism. One of the early stories that the Mesa de Vacas told, when the Spanish were shipwrecked on this island around Galveston, there were like 80 of them. Four of them made it to, eventually to the west coast of the United States. That group of shipwrecked Spaniards resorted to cannibalism, and the Columbus that they were with were disgusted by it. They did not, so in other words, they wouldn't think of eating each other. They might eat an enemy or eat parts of an enemy. So, I think that the identification of Caracas and cannibalism is much exaggerated. When Cabeza de Vaca met them, they were not particularly warlike. They were actually very friendly and very helpful to them. Later, because of their interaction with the European settlers, they became pretty implacable enemies. Stephen F. Austin was able to make peace with a lot of the Indian tribes around San Felipe. He was never able to come to any kind of accommodation with the tribe. So later on, they were certainly seen as being very resistant. Say something else. They were the Caracas were rather primitive in terms of the Indian culture of the time. The Comanches, for example, looked down and hunted them for sport. So they were a simple, primitive group of Indians at the time. Yes, sir.
Do they know what?
There's nothing in the record. I'm guessing that she spoke English. She may not have spoken English when she was immediately orphaned, but I would imagine that she learned English with her adopted name. Yes.
Did anybody try and track the rest of the tribe?
there just seems to be very little in the way of a record after they left this area. And there are some stories about them trying to live along the border. And, I mean, it seemed like they were attacked by some of the other Indian groups. They spoke a language called Wilteca. And so in other words, they may have at some point, you know, have migrated up from the Mexican state of Coahuila. And so it seemed like they were possibly absorbed into the Coahuila population in Mexico. That's all that I know about. Yes.
I have read that I don't know if it was the settler
Grace the Clock.
Yeah. That we have described as very tall for humans.
Yes. I think that's where the original designation. And he was the one, I mean, he was in the family. Mary was about 6 years older than he was. So he grew up with the family stories, and that's what he wrote in his memoir. Philip Power lived, born, I guess it was 1848. He lived in the 1900s. He lived about as long as Mary did. And I cannot find, you know, when he wrote his memoirs, so how far away from the time was he. But she would have been somewhat older, and so most of what he's going to be hearing would have been secondhand stories, I think. But that's where the original idea or designation of Mary as a Chronicle, and he talked about her as if she were full Chronicle. I wish I could find his memoir. I'd love to see them, but I don't know if they still exist. Yes?
Were they agrarian, or were they hunter-gatherers?
Hunter-gatherers.
Yes.
I think in the winter they lived at the coast on oysters, mussels, fish, whatever they could gather. And then in the summer they moved inland a little bit. They never adopted the horse. They mainly used the bow and arrow. They didn't really adopt the gun, either the rifle. They used dugout canoes to get around. They were extremely good shots with a bow and arrow, and their bows were very tall, like 6 feet or more, as tall as they were. So they were strictly hunter-gatherers. Yes.
Now, Philip Power, do you know where his father, grandfather, did you go back on any of their history?
Well, his father was James Power, who had the impresario hunter.
Okay, James, yeah.
James Power.
And he was one of them that established a lot of the Irish impresario in those areas?
Okay. That's correct.
Now, what about the mission at Goliad? Back in the 1722s or something like that, they tried to convert these Indians to civilized ways, or
oh, yeah.
Do you have any information on that, how that worked out, or didn't work out?
Yeah, I've looked at that also. There were three missions in the coastal area. All three of them were established near the coast and, for a variety of reasons, migrated inland. The one that was specifically established to try to instruct the Columbus was the mission at Refugio. And it arrived, it moved into Refugio in 1795. That was near the end, that was at the end of the mission period. That was the last Spanish mission established in Texas. The Carrancas were kind of in and out of there. They didn't stay long. There were some bouts of epidemics there. There were two other missions around Goliad. One is the mission that's on the side of the road, now a state park. At the time, it's called Espiritu Santo. There's two things in Goliad. There's a presidio or a fort, and there's a mission. The presidio is south of the river, the San Antonio River, and the mission, and it's on the east side of the road. The mission is a state park, and it's on the north of the river. And then there was another mission a couple miles away called Rosario. And these were actually established for other groups of Indians. And it was found, the missionaries found, that you could not mix the different groups of Indians because they would fight. And so therefore, each mission was somewhat dedicated to a particular band of Indians. All of the missions were, as they said, secularized by the Mexican government around 1820. Mexico had its revolt in Spain in 1810. The war lasted 11 years. So by 1821, Mexico was an independent country. And all of the missions were secularized, which means that the mission lands were supposed to be given away to the people around the mission. So that was the end of the missions, per se. Some were a little bit more successful than others, but even the missions in San Antonio, it was hard to see a strong lasting effect. The mission buildings were still there. The mission building in Refugio, there's nothing existing of it. It was, the stones were used for other things by the citizens of Refugio in the 1840s. Does that answer the question?
Yeah.
That's kind of the short answer. But the missionaries certainly tried very hard, and their method was to try to get the Indians to move into the mission, and then they would teach them religion as well as farming and weaving and other things. And that was just too big of a cultural transition for the Indians, and therefore they didn't stay very long. I mean, they come in, stay for a week or so, and leave for 2 months or something. They'd come back a little bit. Very frustrating for the missionaries. Yes?
There was an article in the Leeville paper about 6 months ago about Mary,
mm-hmm.
and they had, it's definitely a different story than what we heard tonight.
I gave the same talk in Vigo about 6 months ago. I don't think I've changed my story. What do you remember?
There was a picture with a lady with a tattoo down front of her.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay.
And so that's why, because it seems to lean toward her as a world. And
I think maybe that was, I certainly didn't say that. I mean, I do remember saying at that time that if Mary had been a Columbo, this is what she ought to look like. Okay? And I think I've done some research since then, and I guess I've become more convinced, let's say, that the facts can say, well, she may have been part of Columbo, but we can't say how much. But I would say the fact that she was not tattooed would indicate that she was not born a Columbo. Thank you for bringing that up. No, it's all right.
But if the French orphans were given in, they would be white, and they would be tattooed. So
yes. There were about five or six French children that were taken captive, adopted by the tribe, subsequent to the massacre of La Salle's colony. They were treated pretty well. And when they were later repatriated, let's say, No, they, I think the Carrancos did not go much beyond back in the bay, which is just a little south of Corpus Christi. That's not to say that there may not have been some that moved back and forth, but they were not, as I mentioned, they were primitive. They didn't do a lot of trading, and so they would not have been a tribe, let's say, that would have moved back and forth to Mexico as part of their lifeline. They were very traditional. And I think that maybe is why they objected to the immigrants so much, is that the immigrants kind of came along and locked themselves down in an area that they've been living in for them, you know, forever. And kind of usurped their places. And so it was not hard to see that caused hard feelings. Yes.
Was there any presence in border in the Mosten Island itself of Carrancas?
I'm sorry, say it again.
Was there presence of these people here in Mosten Island and what happened to them?
I don't know.
Yes. You said they never adopted horses?
there is some basis from what I've encountered to say that they may have had dogs. Yes, sir?
It might, from what I've read, there's a lot of Indian tribes, were named by other Indian tribes, and a lot of times those names were given when the Spanish explorers would go in.
Or you don't have to say that anymore.
From what I've read, a lot of the history of that period, a lot of the Indian tribes were named by neighboring tribes. Sometimes they try to give the other neighbors tribal names.
Oh, that's true.
I don't know who might have given them the
name. That's all through the West.
Yeah. If you look at the, not just for the Quanquas, but for many other Indian tribes, and ask them, you know, where's your name come from? What does it mean? It usually translates to be the people. We are the people. And everybody else is something else. And so, they're called something else by everybody else, but their name for themselves are, we are the people. So, and that's not just, that's a fair, to me it seems like a fairly general phenomenon. Yes, ma'am?
So that's the Quanqua name of the Indian tribe. Have any relations to the street
on
the
love of
Corpus Christi
called
the
Quanqua
Street?
Yes, I think the street's named after the tribe. I didn't spend any time, but Quanquas actually had a number of subgroups, and they called them, so they were closely related, but not identical. Quanquas kind of the name that the Spanish, then the Mexicans, then the Anglo applied to all of them, but there was one subgroup called Copan, C-O-P-A-N. Yes. Apparently, this group impressed the Spanish a lot because they named things after this group. Copano Bay is named after this subgroup of the Quanquas. And so you can find in the literature of the time favorable references to the Copans, or you might find unfavorable references to some of the other groups. So there was the differences to the early Spanish explorer and missionaries were very, very. Yes, ma'am.
There's like 100 words in existence left of the language, and I can't find it on the internet somewhere. I mean, is there a place that you can go to on the internet to find the language of the current terms?
It's hard to find, but I look for it. I don't think I found anything on the internet. Where I found it, I can't remember all the places. It's only a few places. Okay. The French children from the Saul's colony wrote down some of the words that they remembered. And then there were one or two early immigrants, I think a diary poem whose name I don't remember, who befriended Columbus living near her house and learned some of their words. I'm afraid I can't. The ones that the French children gave are in a it's in a book. I think it's by a guy by the name of Henri H-E-N-R-I-J-O-U-T-E-L. That's his nothing else. But yes, there are a few, something like 100 words that are known, but you're right, they are kind